So Hebrews chapter 11, and it says, it's just one verse that I wanted to read to you, and it says, "But without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him." Amen? So the Word of God tells us that without faith it's impossible to please God. And what the Word of God wants you and I to know is that God will reward those who diligently seek after him. And the idea of diligently means to seek after, to pursue in the thought that it's going to obtain something. Amen? And so I don't know where you are in your walk. I've been in many places in my walk, but I know one thing. I want to be a man that seeks diligently after the Lord. I want to follow after him. I want to pursue after him in the way that I desire to obtain what it is that he's worthy. You know, we need to understand that this morning. He's worthy to be sought after and to be found. Amen? Amen. But I want you to know that along the way, and that's where I wanted to go in 1 Peter chapter 1, along the way of this journey, as we're seeking him. That's what the journey of Christianity should be about. Seeking him, not seeking self. Not seeking self's desires. Many times that we get caught up in that. Amen? I don't know about you, but I know that I can. We seek after self's desires and what self wants. But the journey of Christianity is really to be seeking after God and what he desires and what he wants. Amen? And so many times on this journey, and it's going to tie back into the ultimate message that I have this morning, which comes again out of the book of Nehemiah. But in this journey, you need to understand that there's many trials of the faith. As you're walking your Christian journey, you will find yourself again and again in the midst of a trial. And this is what we're going to learn in this Peter passage, why that is. And it says right here in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 7, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perishes, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus. So if you can about imagine that we're talking about a diligently seeking after, a walking after, a journey, but also in the midst of that journey, a trying of the faith. A trying of the faith that just as metal is placed in the fire for the purpose of bringing impurities to the top, that you and I will find ourselves in the midst of trials, that where our faith is being placed under a flame in order that it might be found like gold whenever the story is all completed. That there's coming a day that from the beginning when you first gave your life to Jesus, as the song sang about, amen? And it said, I don't know how you felt on that day, but since that day I felt him deep down on the inside of my soul. From that day that you gave your heart to Jesus to the day that you see the Lord when he returns, or whenever you close your eyes, and to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. From that day to that day, there's a journey that's ensuing, and along the way, I have to tell you that there's a trial of your faith, and that your faith is so precious that God's not going to leave it alone. He's not going to leave it right there where it is, but instead, he's going to test it. And many times we find ourselves in the midst of the test and we find ourselves frustrated from it. You need to understand something, and I find myself frustrated from it, but you need to understand something, that your faith, God desires for it to come forth as gold. Amen? Amen. And so he goes on to say in verse 8, whom having not seen you love. See, you haven't seen Jesus with your physical eyes. Nevertheless, you love him. Somebody told you the good news of the gospel. You allowed Jesus on the inside. You accepted him as your Lord and Savior. And even though you haven't seen him with physical eyes, you're here this morning because you love him. He goes on to say, amen, that yet believing you rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. That's the ultimate end of the faith. Amen. That you and I one day will be able to see him. But once again, while we're on this earth, from the first day we received him to the day that we see him, there's a journey that's taking place. Amen? Amen. And the purpose of that journey is that we would reflect the glory of God and that we would reveal God's goodness to a lost and a dying world. Verse 10, of which salvation the prophets have inquired. You understand what that means? It's talking about the Old Testament. It's talking about that God has had one plan. God has had one plan since the garden incident where the fall took place, and he clothed Adam and Eve with the skins of an innocent animal. From that day moving forward, God has communicated one message, that it requires the shedding of blood for the remission of sins. And the prophets foretold through the ages of Israel's history that that day was coming, amen, and that day was manifest in Jesus and what he did for us at the cross. The prophets searched diligently. They prophesied of the grace that should come unto you. The grace of the church age. The grace that was purchased whenever Jesus died on the cross. Not just forgiveness for anything that you've done, but power to strengthen you as you walk your journey of Christianity in the midst of your trial, while your faith is being tested, so that it might come forth more precious than gold. It says, verse 11, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ. See, the Holy Spirit was working even in the Old Testament through the Spirit of Christ. What does the word Christ mean? I've told you this many times, amen, but for maybe somebody new, it means the anointed one, the promised one, the one that was foretold of days of old. It wasn't his last name. It was the one that God said he's coming, amen. And so it says that that these prophets searched diligently, and they testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow. The prophets told us that Jesus was coming. But even Israel, because they didn't understand their scriptures properly, they missed it. They didn't consider Psalm 22, where it said, they've pierced my hands and my feet. They didn't consider Zechariah chapter 12, where it said, in those days, talking about the days of the future, I will pour out a spirit of grace and supplication upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem. And they will look upon me whom they pierced. Who will look? God's people, Israel, they will look upon me whom they pierced, and they will mourn for me as one who mourns for an only son. There's coming a day in the future, and I don't think it's too far away, where Israel is going to realize that they crucified their Messiah. Spiritual scales are going to fall from their eyes, and they're going to have a revelation, and everything that the prophets foretold us was true, and we hung him on a cross, and we counted him cursed, and because of that, we rejected Messiah, and now it's time for us to receive Messiah. Amen.
Amen.
Goes on to say, and to whom it was revealed that not unto themselves but unto us they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. I love that passage. I probably preached that passage 3 times since we opened the church. You may not remember, but the idea is that the angels are peering over. They're looking down upon. And they're viewing this thing that's going on upon the earth. And they're almost, it's the idea is that they're mesmerized. They're taken aback by what's happening in salvation history, about how God is moving in the midst of human lives and how he's restoring humanity unto himself. And let me say this real quick. I know I've said this before, but angels saw God before, even the fallen angels, they saw the glory of God before they fell. The passage says, whom you have not seen, yet you love. See, God understands something, and he created it to be done this way. Even though you haven't seen him with your terrestrial or physical eyes, yet he's placed something in the inside of your heart that you would love him. Yet these fallen angels that saw him with their own celestial eyes chose to rebel against him. And the heavenly angels are peering over, looking at this war that's taking place. I want you to know that before we're over this morning, you need to understand, and I know I say it a lot, but you're in a spiritual war.
Mm-hmm.
You're in a spiritual war, and that's why the physical things that take place in your life and the circumstances that are going on are manifest in the physical realm, because there's a spiritual war, that the battle that's taking place behind the scenes. And I'm telling you right now, if you're anything like me, when you first got saved, this is how I showed up. I was at my sister's house, had long hair down my back, just come out of Van Halen concert, and I just thought I was the coolest thing. And I show up in my house, and I can remember Danielle and my sister were talking about demon spirits. And I remember laughing at them. I'm like, man, y'all are crazy. What is all this stuff about demon spirits? And you know, for the next 5 years, because I couldn't see anything in the spiritual realm. You know what I'm talking about, Rob? Couldn't see anything in the spiritual realm. I was getting myself beat up. I'm here to tell you that you are in a spiritual war. It doesn't matter whether you believe it or not. The things that you're fighting are not a physical fight. It's something that's going on, and we need the Lord to intervene in the midst of the spiritual realm. Amen. I would say all that to say verse 13. It says, gird up your loins.
Yeah.
I've talked to you about this before.
Yeah.
But the idea in this concept is that whenever they would travel in those days, they would have long garments and they'd have a belt. And they'd take that garment and they'd wrap it through and they'd pull it through the belt and they'd pull it up like that. I mean, it is what it is. It's almost like a jock strap. You're getting yourself strapped up ready for war. You're getting yourself strapped up ready for a journey. You're on a journey, Christian. And you're traveling, amen? And you're traveling from day one, whenever you gave your heart to Jesus, to the last day, whenever you're going to see Him. And along the way, you need to get yourself prepared and understand that on the midst of this journey, amen, you need to be sober-minded. That's what it said. Gird up the loins of your mind and be sober and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. We're on a journey. 1 Peter 5:8. Actually, we'll start with 5. 1 Peter 5, starting with part B of the verse. In other words, in the middle of the verse, it says, be clothed with humility. I don't know about you, but that's a problem that Matt's had. To clothe himself with humility. Instead, he has a tendency to want to revert back to pridefulness and arrogance. Is it okay for people to be transparent with you? Is it okay to be honest? You know, I don't know about you, but I think that each and every one of us, to some extent, have dealt with levels of pride in our life. Amen. Because of the fall of man, there's a level of that, a refusal to submit, a refusal to surrender in various ways, a desire to hold on to aspects of self and not let go. He goes on to say, clothe in humility, for God resists the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. Amen. I don't know about you, but see, resistance describes two opposite ends of a magnet that repel each other. But I want God to rush to me. And so in order for that to happen, I have to humble myself. Humble yourselves, therefore, into the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you in due time. Look at this, verse 7. Cast all your care upon Him, for He cares for you. Have you done that, Christian? Whenever you find yourself in the midst of your circumstance on your journey that you're navigating and you find the cares of the world burdening you and laying upon your shoulders, have you taken the time to say, Lord, I can't carry this burden. I cast my cares on You. I don't even know what that means. I don't even know really how to give it to You other than I'm desperate. And I cast my cares on You because I know that You care for me. Amen. He goes on to say this. He says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walks about seeking whom he may devour, whom resist steadfast in the faith. Now, you got to understand that word the right there in front of faith, it's in the Greek language. The New Testament was written in Greek. It's called the definite article. It's talking about a specific kind of faith. It's not just your verb faith. It's talking about the faith. What is that? The plan of God. That God from the beginning, even in the garden, has established a plan. And the plan that He's established is the sacrifice of His Son. And through the faith in the sacrifice of His Son, that's the faith, you have access to the grace of God, the power of God, to strengthen you, amen? So that when you submit to the ways of God and you humble yourself to the ways of God, He will show up and He will manifest His power in the midst of your life and He will give victory, amen? To that area that you're desiring Him to. It may not happen as fast as you want Him to, but let me tell you something. Your adversary, the devil, who roams around like a roaring lion, he wants you to quit. He wants you to give up in the midst of the trial. He wants you to give up in the midst of the test or the journey, wherever it is that you are. Come on, I see people shaking their head. You know what I'm talking about. You've been there. You've heard the whispers of the enemy whenever you're in the midst of the heat of the battle. And what he's telling you, what's the use? Just go on and give up. No, you can't give up. Jesus didn't give up. He endured to the end, amen? He carried the cross up Calvary's hill and He laid His life down in your stead so that you could have access to grace. To be strengthened, to be empowered in order to walk with Him. Amen. Look at this, verse 10. But the God of all grace, who has called us into His eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that you have suffered a while, He will make you perfect. He will establish you. See, that many times the word perfect in the Greek text, it means to be brought to a place of completion, maturity, sanctification. This time it's a different Greek word. And it literally is used to describe the mending of nets. Truth to be told, that you and I, because of the fall, have holes on the inside. We have holes in our nets. I think I told y'all this story one time. My life was so full of sin for so long, and even after I gave my heart to the Lord, I struggled so bad in my walk with God. I kept repeated failures time and again, whether it was just so many different things, lustful things. I mean, I've shared that with y'all, probably said it last week, struggled with pornography, struggled with, you know, alcohol from time to time as a Christian. And one time after the Lord got a hold of me, he sent this young boy to the Bible study that we were having. And he just came out of nowhere. And he got on his knees and worshiped the Lord as we were worshiping. And afterwards he said, you know, the Lord gives me, he lets me see things. He was 16. I was a little bit apprehensive. I don't know how you feel about that kind of thing, but I was like, okay. So I said, why don't we go to the back room over here? He told me this story. He said, well, we were worshiping, the Lord showed me something about you, about your life. Every time I say it, I start to get emotional because I've seen God do what the young man was talking about. He said there was a shrimp boat, and he said there was butterfly nets, and there were holes in the nets. And he said, I said, what is this, Lord? He said, tell him that that's the sin that was in his life. And he said the nets dropped into water, and the fish and the shrimp were going through the holes. He said, what is this, Lord? He said, tell him that that's the souls that were being lost because of the sin that was in his life. And he said, in the next scene, I saw an old man on the deck of the boat, and he was mending the nets. Oh, yeah. And I said, Lord, what does this mean? He said, tell him that I'm mending the nets. The Lord wants to tell you something this morning. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap. Amen. He's the one that mends nets. The Lord wants you to know something this morning. I didn't plan to tell that story. He wants somebody in here to hear that. That the ravages of sin in your life cause holes. And listen, this is from way back when. Things in your life that you didn't even know about. And if we actually get to the message this morning, that's part of what, that's my first point, is that internal damage is taking place because of the fall of man. And many times all we can see is the external, and we see the destruction that takes place in the physical realm, but we're not looking deep enough to understand that there's things on the inside that God's wanting to deal with. And he allows the trials of life in order to pull those things up so that they can be dealt with. You got to understand that. Because many times you won't know why it is that you're in the midst of something. And the Lord wants you to realize that there's things deep down inside that he wants to do business with. Amen. And so I've got good news for you this morning. Even though you find yourself in the midst of a trial, even though sometimes you feel like the fire's so hot, God wants to mend the nets. Amen. He wants to make us whole. You don't need a counselor and you don't need another pill. I'm just telling you. Right now, you don't have to like that. I'm here to tell you, you don't need a pill, you don't need a counselor, you need Jesus on the deck of your boat. Amen. What? Mending the nets. Come on, Lord, mend the nets. Let me see what's in my heart and deal with it. Deuteronomy chapter 8. We're talking about the people of God. We're talking about the people of God. We're talking about a journey. All right. And in Deuteronomy chapter 8. Now, one of the things that I've told you, just in case we've got a couple of visitors today. And I know I said it last week, but y'all just bear with me. Whenever I teach the Old Testament, one of the things that the Lord has revealed unto me is this, is that Old Testament Israel as a whole, they were a people, right? They were God's people. Old Testament Israel as a whole is synonymous, at least in the sense that they are God's people. Now, this is New Testament Christian. He's in Christ, in the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Amen.
His name is Christian. He's the little brother of Israel, if that makes sense. The people of God. I'm just trying to make a point. Because, see, many times you don't hear people talk about that. But the fact of the matter is that what they have in common is that they're both the people of God. And they've both been on a journey. Yes. And they've both made failures. And God has repeatedly had mercy. And God has repeatedly reached out. And God had one plan for Israel, and it's the same plan for Christian. It was the sacrificial system for Israel. It was fulfilled and manifest in the person of Christ when he died on the cross for Christian. Then it was the shedding of blood and our faith in that that allows us to have access to the presence of God. I don't have time to get into it now, but I've taught it multiple times that there was a temple in Jerusalem. Amen. There was a temple in Jerusalem, and behind the veil, there was an Ark of the Covenant, and on top of the Ark of the Covenant was a mercy seat. And once a year on the Day of Atonement, blood was applied to the mercy seat. Contained underneath was the broken law. You and I, born of Adam, have broken the law. But Jesus is our mercy seat. His Amen. Blood was shed, and now the Father no longer sees the broken law in our lives. He sees the mercy seat, the blood of Jesus yes. that has covered, amen, and taken away the sin of man. You have access to the presence Praise of God. Lord. Hallelujah. Yes. And so we're going to see in Israel's life, and that's what I put up there, the Exodus. See, Deuteronomy that I'm about to preach, read to you, this quick passage, Israel was captive in Egypt. And you see a repeated scenario taking place in the lives of the people of God. They were captive in Egypt for all of these 400 years, and then finally they're led out of the Exodus. That's a blessing, amen, whenever God pulls you out of captivity.
Yes.
But then they find themselves wandering in a wilderness, and then God brings them into the promised land. And then they find themselves in the time frame of the judges where they're failing God. The point is that it's not uncommon for God's people to make repeated mistakes. But God does have a plan of freedom, and He wants you and I to believe it and to hold on to it. And then finally, in the time frame of the judges, they had the kings, and they cried for a king. And we don't have time to get into it too much, but finally God gave them David. And under David's leadership, who was a type of Christ, the nation of Israel had great power. They were the superpower of the world. But then from that time moving forward, after Solomon, all of the kings went after false gods. And much of the modern church today, I'm sorry, I'm not going to back up from it, I'm not going to shrink from it, is not preaching the truth about Jesus. They're preaching a watered-down message, and they're tickling people's ears. You and I need to hear the truth. We need to hear the truth that Jesus is the only way, that it's not what you do, but it's what He did, amen? That you can't do enough to be pleasing in the eyes of God. You can't come to church enough. By the way, we have church tonight at 6 o'clock, and we have church on Thursday nights at 7 o'clock. But you can't come to church enough to make yourself right in the eyes right. of God. Come on. You can't read enough Bible. You can't pray enough. Jesus, He's the one that did it right. He's the obedient one. And when you put your faith in what He did, hey man, you're covered with His righteousness. It gives you access to the grace of God. You got to believe that. Hope in that. Trust in that. Amen? And what I want you to know, though, is that during this time frame of the kings, they were disobedient to the plan of God, and God brought them into captivity. And one of the things that I wanted to point out with this, is that ultimately they were brought under Babylon first. You see that a succession of kingdoms. I'm going to keep telling you this until you know it better than I do. Babylon, Persia, Greece, Rome. Alexander the Great, remember that? Rome during Jesus' time. All this matters to you when you read the Bible to understand these things. That's why we have to do, we've got to turn Sunday school into our morning Sunday sermon, amen, to mix it all together so that we learn together, amen? What we're talking about right now is Persia, Nehemiah. See, you remember that? You ever heard that saying, the handwriting's on the wall? I think I figured out where it came from. Remember last week when we talked about that passage in Daniel? And it said the time that Jeremiah had spoke of had come to an end. And Daniel had gone to prayer, amen? And all of a sudden, King Nebuchadnezzar's son was having a party. Remember that? And he said, hey, while we're in the midst of this party, by the way, go get those cups that we took from Israel whenever we conquered them and we showed them who the boss was, because my daddy was bad back in those days. And so they brought those cups and they were drinking wine out of the cups of Israel's, out of Jerusalem's, the things that they had in the tabernacle. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, comes a handwriting on the wall. Some hand just shows up and starts writing some stuff in the middle of the Aramaic language is what it was. And it says, it tells them, you have been weighed and found wanting in the balances. Tonight your kingdom is taken from you. And what I wanted to tell you about that last week was that caused a physical shift to take place. God allowed a spiritual shift to take place and allowed that hand to show up. You know, the Lord showed me this too. That Nephilim, what was his name? Og, king of Bashan. I believe that's where King Si's bed came from. He had a 13-foot bed. I don't know. I'm just seeing all these things. I'm sorry. That was a rabbit trail. But listen. Handwriting on the wall. You've been found wanting. And tonight your kingdom is taken from you. And God allowed something spiritual to take place that changed something in the physical realm. And I don't know about you, but sometimes whenever I find myself in the midst of a circumstance, I'm ready for the Lord to allow something spiritually to happen for there to be a change in the physical realm. Amen. Hallelujah. And so we're in the time frame of Persian rule. And I'm just going to real quickly tell you that there was an edict that had gone forth. Because of the captivity of Israel, Jerusalem was destroyed. The walls were broken down. The gates were burned. There's a heap of stones that are burned and everything's piled up. It looks like an ancient 9/11 is what's going on here. The people of God are in captivity. And Nehemiah was the king's cupbearer. We talked about that last week. And he was sad of his countenance in the face of the king. And the king asked him, what's going on? What's wrong? And he tells him about his people. And all of a sudden, the king gives an edict and says, go back and rebuild the wall. Because they're desiring to rebuild the temple. Why? So that they can have an Ark of the Covenant. Why? So that the presence of God in Exodus 25, which said, my presence will dwell with my people. But in order for that to happen, there's got to be an altar. Because God won't dwell with his people without the shedding of blood. Amen? And so they're desiring to reestablish the altar. But whenever the walls are broken down in a person's life, come on somebody, the enemy has an opportunity to come in and to wreak havoc and to wreak destruction. And so God's allowing Nehemiah to come back in order to lead or spearhead a movement of rebuilding the wall around Jerusalem. And so that's where we are in this story. But before we go there, let's work on Deuteronomy 8. It says in Deuteronomy 8 verse 2, all the commandments which I command thee this day shall you observe to do, that you may live and multiply and go in and possess the land which the Lord swore unto your fathers. And you shall remember all the way which the Lord your God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness to humble thee and to prove thee, to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. So what this was the last point I was trying to make about the journey. Before they moved into the Exodus, God tells Israel, remember the 40 years. Remember the 40 years? I'm sorry, they've already gone through the Exodus. They've been in the wilderness. They're about to enter the promised land. Remember the 40 years of the wilderness. I put you there. I'm the one that put you there. You didn't, you helped yourself stay there, but I put you there. And I put you there for a purpose. I allowed you to stay there because I wanted to prove you. The word prove there means to put to the test. And it literally is descriptive, again, of metals. That metals are put to the test of the fire to prove them, to allow what's in them that needs to come out, to humble, he said. I wanted to humble you. I wanted to test you. I wanted to show you what was in you. God allows tests in your life to show you what's in you. And he wants to give you the opportunity to keep the commandments of the Lord. He wants to give you the opportunity to do his will and not to fail him and not to transgress him. Amen. And so I wanted to encourage you with that. But listen, what happens is that they end up in captivity later. But I wanted you to see this in Jeremiah, and you don't have to turn there. I'll just tell it to you. So for time, and I can turn to Nehemiah 4. In Jeremiah 17, verses 10 and 11, God used Jeremiah to prophesy. I know I'm bouncing back and forth chronologically, but I hope that at some point y'all can follow me closely. God used Jeremiah at the end of the king period to prophesy about this right here. He said that this was going to take place for 70 years. But before it even happened, in Jeremiah 17, 10 and 11, he said, when the 70 years is up, I'm going to strike Babylon for you. And I'm going to free you. He said, because I have a plan for your life. I have a future and a hope for your life. What the Lord wanted me to tell you this morning was this. Was that before you ever even found yourself in the trial that you find yourself in, or if you're not in one right now, next week, whenever it shows up. God, before he even allowed you to be in there, he already had the plan for the results of it. To give you a future and a hope. God doesn't think evil towards you. God has a plan for you. But he also understands how to get you from point A, the first day that you gave your life to Jesus, to point B, the day that you see him. Amen?
Lord, yes.
And so, Lord, all I can say is help me in the midst of the trial to keep my eyes on you.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes,
so that I can see the future and the hope that you have planned towards your people. Amen. And so here we are in Nehemiah chapter 4. The first point I wanted to make was, is once again, about internal damage. And the reason that I say that is this, is that last week what we said was that when Nehemiah got his orders to go back to Jerusalem, he came from Persia, which is modern day Iran, and he traveled back to Jerusalem. And when he did it, he really didn't make a big fanfare about it. And he went at nighttime and he only brought one beast, meaning I didn't bring a whole bunch of animals. I didn't bring a whole bunch of people because I didn't want everybody, didn't want to make a fuss. And what he saw was this. He saw the walls for the first time. He had been told by the ear about the destruction of sin that had taken place in Israel's life. I've told you this before. I can tell you about sin all day long, but until you experience it for yourself, what it'll do to you. Amen. And then the delivering power of the Lord that when he pulls you out of it, then you really have a revelation of it. Amen. So Nehemiah went from hearing the story about how bad it was to that night he showed up and he saw it with his own physical eyes. He saw the walls broken down. He saw the gates burned. He saw the heaps and the piles of rubble and the burnt stones. But I got to tell you something. Not only did Nehemiah see it, but as we're going to see in chapter 4, the enemy of God saw it also. It says right here in chapter 4, verse 1, "But it came to pass when Sanballat heard that we builded the wall." Now I want you to go down to the beginning of verse 3 and see that where it says, "Now Tobiah the Ammonite." So we have two names here, Sanballat and Tobiah. Now, I thought this was interesting. Sanballat means, it can mean one of two things. It can mean the moon, there that the moon god brings life. Now, I can tell you, I've done a lot of studying behind the origins of the occult in order to know their history. And the moon god is Satan. Yes. And it's the same god that the Islamic people follow after, even though they call him Allah. Okay, it's the moon god, and that's who he is. He's Satan, as the occultists call him, Lucifer, the bearer. They call him the bearer of light. But this word also means God is. It talks about strength. And so what I want you to know is that this is a liar, and this is representative of the devil, and it's representative of the strength of the devil. It's representative of a stronghold of the devil. What's a stronghold? A stronghold in people's lives is something that grabs a hold of them and it won't let go. Oh, come on. If you know what I'm talking about, some people have struggled with addictions of various sorts. Some people have struggled with all kinds of different things. But a stronghold is something that has a hook on the inside of you and it don't want to let go. And between that and Tobiah, whose name means Jehovah is God, that he's false doctrine. Because he's over here acting like he loves the God of Israel, but him and Sanballat are working together to bring destruction and to mock the people of God and to laugh at them and the work of God in their face. And I want you to know this, is that false doctrine or deception along with strongholds work hand in hand in the arsenal of the enemy to strike fear in the hearts of the people of God. You need to understand that. That is a tactic of the enemy, that he wants to hold on to a stronghold, and then he wants to keep people under an improper understanding of the gospel so they don't know where to keep their faith, place their faith in the finished work of Christ, and instead of freedom and liberty, they find themselves remaining under the bondage of the stronghold. But I'm here to tell you that the stronghold will be broken. God uses the trials of your life to reveal strongholds in your life, to reveal things that are going on in your life so that you, in the midst of your desperation, will cry out to him so that he can show up and he can apply the cross to that area of your life and allow that old man to die, amen, so a new man can be resurrected to newness of life. That's the first thing I wanted you to see, is that the enemy of God is, look what he does, going back to verse 1. "When Sanballat heard that we builded the wall, he was wroth," or full of anger, "and he took great indignation and he began to mock the Jews." I want you to know that not only did Nehemiah see the damage that had taken place, but the enemy of God saw the damage that took place. And listen, he goes on to say, look what he says, "And he spoke before the brethren and the army of Samaria," that's the enemies of God. And he said, "What do these feeble Jews, what do these feeble Jews, what is their plan?" The word feeble means weak. I'm thinking to myself, yeah, we're weak. That's right. You know, Ted Turner said one time on TBS, Christians are weak. Christianity is a crutch. And I can remember I wasn't even doing well with the Lord. I was thinking, a crippled man needs a crutch, Ted.
And you wouldn't do bad if you got a hold of one your own self. The fact of the matter is that the sooner we come to the realization that we're no match for the enemy in our own strength, the better off we're going to be. Amen? The Apostle Paul said in 2 Corinthians 12:9, I asked the Lord 3 times to remove this thing from me, but the response of Jesus was, "My grace is sufficient for you. In weakness, my strength is made perfect." Come on, feeble Jews. Yeah, we're feeble, but we're going to hold on to Jesus in the midst of the trial, and we're going to trust Him, amen, until He gets us through. Look what He says. Will they fortify themselves? In other words, are they going to build this wall? And the idea is separation. They're going to try to separate themselves from us, the enemy. Will they fortify themselves? Will they sacrifice? You know, I have to tell you that there was a long period of time where there was no smoke in the air. I mentioned that to you last week. What are you talking about smoke? Well, whenever there was a sacrifice, they burned that animal and there was smoke in the air. And now all of a sudden, they're reestablishing the altar. And whenever the enemy sees smoke, you see it's the same thing. Not only did Nehemiah see the destruction of the walls, not only does the enemy of God see the destruction of the fall, the enemy also saw the answer in the garden. Come on, we're talking about an internal problem here. This is bigger than your ex-husband. This is bigger than the mess that you find yourself in the midst of. All the external damage that you survey and view. There's something internally going on the inside of our lives. It's called the fall of man.
Yes.
The Word of God. See, the problem isn't so much the broken walls. The problem is that the temple needs to be rebuilt. The problem is that the altar needs to be reestablished. The problem is that we need the presence of God back in Jerusalem. Amen? Good. The problem is we need the presence of God back in our hearts and in the midst of our lives. And we need to reestablish the altar in our lives. We need to make sure that our faith is properly placed in God's eternal plan, which was the giving of His Son to die on the cross in our place. Amen. But I have to tell you, amen. I have to tell you something, that this time frame has taken place. But in the fall, He said, the enemy told Eve, "No, the day that you eat thereof, your eyes are going to be opened and you will become as gods." And she partook. And then the Word of God says that they hid themselves from the presence of God. The answer for that hiding, for that feeling of separation, was that He clothed them with the skins of an animal. An innocent animal that had nothing to do with the sin of Adam and Eve. The enemy of God was in the garden and he saw that plan take place. And I'm telling you, in this Nehemiah story, the enemy of God sees the fall and its effects that it's had in people's lives. And he mocks, and he laughs, and he scoffs, and he tells the people of God, "Your plan, you're weak, this is feeble. What do you think you're going to do, rebuild your wall and separate yourself from the world? You're not going to separate yourself from the world because the world has too much of a hold on you. I'm Stronghold. My name is Sanballat, and I will hold on to you, and I will snatch a hold of you, and I will not let go of you. And my buddy Tobiah, false doctrine, is going to help keep you right here next to me, and I'm here to tell you, you will not let go." But the enemy also saw those skins in that garden. And now they're starting to see the smoke wanting to climb in the air again. And they're showing up and they're trying to frustrate the plan of God. He goes on to say right here in the rest of that verse, "Will they revive the stones out of the heaps of the rubbish which are burned?" And the word "revive" means to give life again. Amen. And I want you to know that that's what God does. He brings resurrection power. Praise God. He makes dead things live. Amen. Look at verse 4. You know, I'm thinking about all this going on. It goes on to say in verse 3, "Now Tobiah the Ammonite was by him, and he said, 'Even that which they build, if a fox goes up, he shall even break down their stone wall.'" I mean, he's just laughing at him. A little fox, a little light canine type animal, hops up and he kind of moves around real quickly. Little light thing. He's going to jump up on their wall and break it down. He's clowning them. He's making fun of them. Right? In the midst of what they're over here working and trying to get things done. And I started thinking to myself, before I got to read any further, I started thinking about poor old Nehemiah. I mean, here he is. He's been given a decree by God, by the king, to go back to Jerusalem to rebuild these walls so that the plan of God can move forward. And here the enemy is scoffing at him and laughing at him. I'm thinking, Nehemiah, don't give up, man. That's what I was thinking. Don't quit. In the midst of it all, don't quit. And it's almost like, as I read down a little bit lower, he said, "Did you read my story, preacher? I didn't quit. Go ahead, go down to this trial, amen, and we're going to walk through it, and we're going to watch God show up. There's going to be adversity in your life, Christian. Amen, because you live on a fallen earth. Yes. There's going to be adversity in your life, but you can't quit.
Right.
You can't quit in the midst of the journey. You got to hold on to Him. Amen?
Right.
And you
got
to keep on pushing through with faith in what God has done. He goes on to say, Nehemiah says, "Hear, O God," verse 4. "Hear, O our God, for we are despised and turned our reproach upon their own head. Give them for a prey in the land of captivity, and cover not their iniquity, and let not their sin be blotted out from before thee. For they have provoked you to anger before the builders." In verse 6, "So built we the wall." You can do all your scoffing enemy. You can do all of your fear tactics. You can do whatever it is that you desire to do. But the man of God has a revelation from God. And he said, "We're going to keep on building the wall. We're going to keep on moving forward. We're going to keep on holding on to Jesus, even in the midst of it. And all the wall was joined together unto the half thereof, for the people had a mind to work." Amen. Help us have a mind to work, Lord, the right kind of work, the work of faith, amen, to move forward in the true gospel, to move forward with the plan of God, amen?
Amen.
All right, let's look at verses 7 through 11. This is the next point I wanted to make with you, and it has to do with the enemy wants to strike fear in your life, but the first thing he wants to do is take your praise away. I want you to see that right here. See, if he can remove your praise from your lips, if he can remove the hope from your heart, he'll begin to break you down. He'll begin to break down your faith. He'll begin to steal your joy. Because your focus now is no longer on the Lord and what he can do. Your focus now is on your circumstances. And the fact that you don't feel like you can get out of it. I'm here to tell you that you need a preacher to tell you that's not true. You need a preacher to remind you that no, there's nothing impossible for God. Amen. God will show up in the midst. And he'll turn everything around. All right, let's go ahead and read verse 7. "But it came to pass when Sanballat and Tobiah and the Arabians and the Ammonites and the Ashdodites heard that the walls of Jerusalem were made up and that the breaches began to be stopped, when they were very wroth," they're angry again, they stay mad the whole time. The devil's mad, by the way. I want you to know that. He is mad. He's mad at God. Listen, we're not playing tiddlywinks here or whatever that means. That was an old game they used to play back in the day. I'm old. Okay, we're not playing tiddlywinks. This is serious stuff. The enemy of our soul knows what lies around the corner for him. He knows what the plan of God is for him. It's called a lake of fire. It's called Gehenna. And he and a third of the angels are going to find their eternity there. The enemy of our soul is not going to quit. He's going to keep on scoffing, and he's going to keep on attempting to destroy your life and to destroy your walk with God. I'm telling you, this is serious business. Many people that stand behind the pulpit nowadays, they don't take it serious anymore. It's all about just trying to make the people feel good about themselves. No, we're in a spiritual war, and you need to understand that. Amen? He goes on to say, verse 8, "And conspired all of them together to come and to fight against Jerusalem and to hinder it. Nevertheless, we made our prayer unto our God and set a watch against them day and night because of them." And look at this. This is the part I want you to see. Verse 10. "And Judah said, the strength of the bearers of burdens is decayed." It means it's being spoiled. It's destroyed. In other words, the strength of our people that used to be able to bear a burden, it's spoiled. It's decayed. It has no strength left in it. This is Judah, the tribe of Judah, a leader of the tribe of Judah speaking. "And the strength of the bearers of the burdens is decayed, and there's much rubbish." In other words, this is a mess. The mess of the fall is too great. The destruction that I see in my life because of the fall is too great. It goes on to say, "so that we are not able to build the wall." Nehemiah is saying, "Let's build the wall." And the leader of Judah is saying that it's too bad. The mess is too big. We can't go on. There's no hope in the midst of the situation. And look at this, when your adversary hears that. "And our adversary said, they shall not know, neither see, till we come in the midst among them and slay them and cause their work to cease." When the enemy sees your praise, I'm about to explain to you why Judah is praised. Just give me a second. When the enemy sees that he is able to steal the praise in your life, he begins to move in and he begins to cause infiltration. And he begins to cause deceit and destruction
in the midst of your life. Let's turn real quick to Genesis 29. Judah. So right now we're in this time frame here, and I'm just kind of shooting from the hip. I would imagine we're somewhere around 500 BC. That's just a guess. All right? 500 BC. I'm going to just tell you, I'm going on a chronological thing here. And so we're talking back around 2000 BC or so about the life of Abraham and his son Isaac and his son Jacob. And Jacob had 12 sons, and one of them's name was Judah. Jacob had two wives, right? One named Leah, one named Rachel. Y'all remember that story? Rachel was beautiful. Leah, something going on with her eyes. We don't know if they just looked funny or if she was blind. Nevertheless, Jacob loved him some Rachel. And he didn't really love Leah the way that she desired to be loved. All right? And it's really can be hurtful, to be perfectly honest with you, because people feel loneliness like that, and people feel pain. And, you know, sometimes, you know, we make jokes to try to be, I guess, to lighten things up, but sometimes it's not really that funny, you know, because I know one thing, I want to be mindful of how other people feel. I don't want to go around hurting people purposely. I want to be soft and I want to be compassionate because that's how Jesus was. I know I have a long way to go. I don't know why I'm saying this. It's on my heart. I know I have a long way to go, but I don't want to be that. I don't want to be hard and hurtful towards people. I want to be kind and compassionate. Amen. Amen? Because that's the heart of Jesus. But nevertheless, that's the situation. Genesis chapter 29, it says in verse 30, and he went in also unto Rachel. We're talking about Judah. I'm trying to explain to you how Judah is praised and what the significance of Judah in the midst of your battle is. He went also unto Rachel, and he loved also Rachel more than Leah. And he served with him, talking about his father-in-law, yet 7 other years. And when the Lord saw that Leah was hated, or really the word can mean not loved as much, he opened her womb, but Rachel was barren. And Leah conceived and bare a son, and she called his name Reuben. For she said, surely the Lord has looked upon my affliction. Now therefore my husband will love me. Can you see her heart? She wants love so bad. She wants to find fulfillment so much. She's hoping that anything that she does is going to bring what she's desiring to find. And it goes on to say, and Leah conceived and bare that son. In verse 33, and she conceived again and bare a son and said, because the Lord has heard that I was hated, he has therefore given me this son also. And she called his name Simeon. So the first one didn't work. So she's hoping that the second one will. She conceived again, verse 34, and bare a son and said, now this time will my husband be joined unto me, because I have borne him 3 sons. Therefore was his name called Levi. You see her in the midst of this trial, and it's just not really getting better. It's not going the way that she desires for it to go. It's not happening the way that she hopes for. Verse 35, and she conceived again and bare a son. And she said, now will I praise the Lord. Now will I praise the Lord. And that's what the name Judah means. It means praise. The first son didn't give me what I wanted. The second son didn't give me what I wanted. The third son didn't give me what I wanted. I don't know how many times I can do this. At some point in time, I got to quit with my own plan, and I got to trust in the Lord, and I got a desire to praise Him. No matter what my circumstances are, no matter what I see myself in the midst of, and praise literally means to acknowledge God for His worth, for He is. So it doesn't matter if the sky is cloudy and the rain is falling. The truth of the matter is that God is worthy to receive praise because He's altogether God. Amen? Yes. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I wanted to take you to one more spot about Judah. It's in Judges. Judges chapter 1. That's after the book of Joshua. And so here we are. We've gone through this process. Judah was born way over here. The literal person Judah was born way over here, 2000 BC, time frame of Abraham. And now we're going all the way to the book of Judges. This is probably about, 500 years later. Now they're the tribes of Judah. And over here in Persia, another
probably another 500 years later, there's still the tribe of Judah. So I just want you to see how the name is moving. But in the time frame of the judges, God is allowing the enemy once again to have victory over his people's life because of their disobedience. And it says in the book of Judges, chapter 1, "Now after the death of Joshua, it came to pass that the children of Israel asked the Lord, saying, 'Who shall go up for us against the Canaanites first to fight against them?' And the Lord said, 'Judah shall go up. Behold, I have delivered the land into his hand.'" Amen. So I want you to see that when you find yourself in the midst of a battle, that Judah is to be put in the battle first. Now, let's take one more step here, and then we're going to stop with this thought. That Judah ends up being the tribe from which David came. King David. You know that, right? And it's from David, King David, that Jesus comes. So whenever we talk about putting Judah first in the battle, listen to me. Do you realize that God knew how the plan was going to work before he wrote it? Amen. Amen? Do you realize that God wrote even in the book of Judges when he said, "Put Judah in the midst of the battle first. I have given him the land," that he was talking about the seed of Judah, talking about the fact that he was giving Jesus the land and giving Jesus the victory, amen, and that you, when you find yourself in the midst of the trial, you need to put Jesus in the battle because you can't fight the enemy on your own, and not only that, you need to, hey, hallelujah, we give you praise and glory, and you don't need to let the devil steal your praise. Oh, how do I do that, preacher? Well, listen, when you feel down and you feel bad about the situation, just take a time out break.
That's right.
And say, "Lord, I don't know what I'm going to do, but I desire to sing praise from my lips to you." Come on, isn't that hard? "Lord, I don't feel it right now, but I'll say this. I know what your word says. Your word says you died on the cross to destroy the works of Satan.
Yes.
Your word says that you died on the cross to give me victory and liberty. And even though I might not feel it in my life right now, I choose with my lips to thank you,
yes,
to acknowledge you for who you are." Yes. Amen.
Amen.
I give you glory.
Yes.
Praise God. Back to Nehemiah, and we're going to close.
Yes. Whew. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Nehemiah. We'll probably finish this thought tonight. I'm learning you can't preach it all in one sermon.
Oh.
For every time you say "oh," somebody else is saying, "Oh man, I wish this guy could stop." Thank you, Annette. You almost pushed me to move forward, but I'm going to be better. Praise God. It says right here, verse 12. We're just going to read all the way from verse 12 to verse 21. Nehemiah chapter 4. "And it came to pass that when the Jews which dwelt by them came, they said unto us 10 times, 'From all places whence ye shall return unto us, they will be upon you.' Therefore set I in the lower places behind the wall, and on the higher places I even set the people after their families with their swords, their spears, and their bows." So he's setting up families on the wall. And they got swords and spears and bows in their hand. Amen. So they're building the wall, but they got weapons in their hands. "And I looked and rose up and said unto the nobles and to the rulers and to the rest of the people, 'Be not ye afraid of them. Remember the Lord, which is great and terrible, and fight for your brethren, your sons and your daughters, your wives and your houses.' And it came to pass when our enemies heard that it was known unto us, and God had brought their counsel to naught, that we returned all of us to the wall, everyone unto his work. And it came to pass from that time forth that the half of my servants wrought in the work," in other words, half of them worked, "and the other half of them held the spears, the shields, and the bows, and the harbingers, and the rulers were behind all the house of Judah, they which built it on the wall, and they that bear burdens, with those that laid it, every one with one of his hands wrought in the work, and with the other hand held a weapon. For the builders, every one had his sword girded by his side, and so builded, and he that sounded the trumpet was by me. And I said unto the nobles, and to the rulers, and to the rest of the people, 'The work is great and large, and we are separated upon the wall, one far from another. In what place, therefore, ye hear the sound of the trumpet, resort there unto us. Our God shall fight for us.'" Amen. Verse 21, "So we labored in the work,
and half of them held the spears from the rising of the morning till the stars appeared. I'm going to turn real quick to Ephesians 6, and I promise I'm really closing. But the point to number three is this, is that you really are in a spiritual war. Amen? And you see the midst of the circumstance, and you see them on the wall. And with one hand, they have a trowel in their hand, and they're building a wall. And in the other hand, they have a weapon. Amen? And I want you to know that while you're in the midst of the work of God, you're going to have to be diligent, vigilant, sober-minded, aware that you have an adversary. And that's what it says in Ephesians 6. It talks about the fact that we are in a spiritual war. It says in verse 11, put on the whole, this is Ephesians 6 verse 11, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Yeah. The word wiles is in the Greek is methodia, methods. He has methodologies. He has plans. He has trickery. He has deception. Amen? And you need to be aware that he has methods that he works in. Yeah. Verse 12, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Mm-hmm. There's a spiritual battle that's ensuing. Now the word wrestle is interesting because it's talking about an individual fight, like a gladiator, gladiator on gladiator. What you and I need to understand is that we're talking about Nehemiah and the unity of God's people, but also the spiritual fight is an individual battle where the enemy wants to take you out.
Amen.
He wants to take you out.
Yes.
And if he takes you out, or he takes me out, it causes a breach in the midst of the wall. It causes the world. Listen, it's important for you and I to walk right with the Lord. It's important. It means something for you and I to hold on to Jesus. Amen. And to allow him to do his work in the midst of our lives. It's important because the world is watching. Amen. And we, even though we're individuals and we're in the midst of an individual fight, whenever things go wrong in our lives, people around us see it. Lord, help us to be reminded that we're in a wrestling match with the forces of evil. You're not wrestling against flesh and blood, verse 12, but against principalities, powers, the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Verse 13, wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand, means to resist in the evil day, and having done all to stand. I need you to know something.
Yes.
The evil day. It's actually talking about a specific day that's going to come in your life. You're probably not going to know it's coming. You're probably not going to even be expecting it. It's going to show up out of the midst of nowhere. Maybe you've already had that day. I've had a couple of them. Things that are unexpected.
Amen.
Things that you never planned was going to happen. It's a specific day, a day of trial, a day of testing, a day of oppression coming upon your life. The Lord says you're in a spiritual battle. You're in a wrestling match. You're not fighting flesh and blood. It's a spiritual thing. You need to stand, amen, in Christ. That's what the armor of God is. It's Jesus. You stand in Christ and you hold on to him. And you believe that what he did was enough to give you access to the power of God. To strengthen you, amen. And to get you through in the midst of the battle. Amen. Hallelujah.